in this episode of TightBeam from Mars.
Operating the Mars Desert Research Station in Utah in the United States, we've had over 250 crews that have gone through our station.
Hi, my name is Aneta, and I'm a software tester in Pyramid Games. At Pyramid Games, we are fascinated by science and discovery. Computer games are our medium, our tool for telling exciting stories about discovering the unknown and colonizing new worlds before it's possible in real life. And we are strongly inspired by the people who work towards the goal of humanity becoming a multi-planet species. Last time, we showed you some interesting footage from the HiSys base, and now we have a special privilege to visit different simulated space station, the Mars Desert Research Station, operated by the Mars Society. The Mars Society is one of the world's largest and most influential space advocacy organizations dedicated to the human exploration and settlement of the Red Planet.
That's right, Jeff. We've been talking with Pyramid Games in Poland. They're working on Occupy Mars.
The Mars Society works to educate the public, the media, and the government on the benefits of exploring Mars.
The Mars Pioneer Award presented to Elon Musk by the chapters and members of the Mars Society, the 15th International Mars Society Convention, held in Pasadena, California, USA, August 3rd through 5th, 2012, for outstanding achievement in furthering the goal of the human exploration and settlement of Mars.
Yeah, it's great to be before so many people who believe strongly in the establishment of life on Mars.
And also conducts research for creating a permanent human presence on the Red Planet.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much, Elon. We're all pulling for you. Good luck.
Their activities also include operating Mars analog simulations in the Utah desert and the Canadian Arctic, public outreach, and many educational programs such as MarsVR, virtual reality simulations they're currently working on. In the next episodes, we would like to bring you closer to actions taken by those passionate people working in many locations and organizations around the world. And, like in any other episode of TightBeam from Mars, you can also count on some sneak peeks from our upcoming game, Occupy Mars. So, let's start our adventure with Mars Society.
Hi, my name is James Burke, and I'm the Director of Information Technology and MarsVR for the Mars Society. The Mars Society was founded in 1998, and we're the world's largest nonprofit organization focused on sending people to Mars. Starting in 2001, we began operating the Mars Desert Research Station in Utah in the United States. Over the last 20 years, we've had over 250 crews comprised of over 1,500 individuals that have gone through our station. One of our crew members, Jessica Watkins, is now an astronaut with NASA. I was fortunate enough to be the executive officer of crew 197 at the station, and I'll be the commander of crew 261 later this year. Back in October 2018, as part of my crew 197, we undertook a one-week mission where we captured additional terrain for the MarsVR project. We also practiced living and working on Mars. We were trained on how to use the analog spacesuits that we use at the station. We learned how to put on a flight radio and clip it to our ear, put on our boots and gaiters, which are like ankle socks. Then we would put on our gloves, our backpack, and our helmet, and then we'd be ready to go outside and explore Mars. We are putting all those procedures into the MarsVR application as well.
When we designed this game, we created the spacesuit also consisting of the helmet, backpack, gloves, and high boots for rough terrain. So it turned out our assumptions regarding the real life on Mars were correct.
To go through the airlock, you essentially have to wait for 3 minutes. We do that to simulate a depressurization cycle. So it gets pretty cramped and crowded in the airlock, especially when there's a bunch of big humans along with you. But after your 3 minutes are up, you're eager to get outside and explore the Martian terrain. And that first step, when you go outside of the airlock and it's quiet and you're wearing your gear, it's very surreal. It really feels like you're exploring Mars.
In the game, we need to care about the realism but also fun gameplay. So in our case, the airlocks are working much faster. In the future, when more people arrive on Mars, the technology will improve and very efficient pumping systems will enable quick entering and exit the airlock.
The Mars Desert Research Station campus is made up of several facilities. The main building is called the HAB, and that is a simulation of a landed spacecraft on Mars. It's using the Mars Direct plan, which would allow a crew of 4 to 6 to transit from Earth in that habitat. They'd spend 6 to 9 months in space, where that would be their home and their spacecraft. They would be able to shelter from solar flares, and they would have some protection from other radiation hazards during the transit between Earth and Mars. Then they would land on that spaceship and begin to explore the surroundings.
In the game, solar flares can happen as well, represented by auroras visible on the sky. During this time, player takes damage even if his spacesuit is fully charged, unless he finds a shelter to avoid irradiation during solar storm.
We also have several other buildings. The Green Hab is essentially a greenhouse. It's a traditional greenhouse. It was set up to help do plant experiments. We use it to grow cherry tomatoes and salad greens and other foods that we then allow the crews to consume. It's not the main food source for the crews, but it is a supplemental food source. And we typically have other biology and plant experiments going during any given field season.
We also have the greenhouse building in the game. We'll dedicate a special episode to talk about it in more detail. In the game, player will have to depend only on the food he produces. But aside from potatoes, we also have tomatoes, lettuce, and other vegetables. Unless he finds some pre-processed food ration packs.
The science dome is a half geodesic dome. It was originally built as part of a crowdfunding campaign to build a new green hab. However, we decided that it was hard to manage the temperature in there, and so we converted it to be used as a general science laboratory. Right now, it has all of our equipment for analyzing samples for biological and geological samples, and there's other equipment in there as well. Our solar panel array is one of the two main ways we power the campus. Our solar panel array provides a large amount of power, several kilowatt hours, and there are a set of batteries in the science dome that store the power when it's not being used. Our secondary power source is a diesel generator. We recently got a new diesel generator, so we're excited about that. And that is also the backup power source when the solar array is not working for some reason. Another building is called the RAM. That's the repair and assembly module. And that is a Chinook helicopter body that's been retrofitted to be an engineering workbench and a tool chest. And so we use that room, that facility, we use that to repair equipment and to work on projects. When I was there, we used it to build a small case for our Raspberry Pi touchscreen computer that then we mounted to the wall of the HAB. So we did some of the work on that in the RAM.
Many objects in our game are controlled by electronic circuit boards. During sandstorms and other weather events, those PCBs can break, which then need to be fixed by the player using a special workbench. The workbench is also a place for upgrading tools.
There's also two observatories on campus. There's the Musk Observatory, which was originally donated by Elon Musk, and that's who we named it after, the Musk Observatory. So as you can imagine, the skies in southern Utah are very clear, and it's a great place to make observations for astronomy. And as far as transportation on campus, we have two modes of transportation, although we only use one during simulations. We have our rovers, which are Polaris EV vehicles, and we can ride on those with our spacesuits on. It's kind of like a cross between a golf cart and a pickup truck. It's an off-road vehicle that's fully electric. It can go over the dirt roads near the campus, and you can carry cargo, and you can have two astronauts ride in them. One person drives and the other person is a passenger. In a pinch, in an emergency, you can also put two more in the cargo bay. And then the other vehicles we have available are ATVs. We don't normally use those during simulations, but they are a lot of fun to ride around on. And you know, I'm looking forward to trying those out with Occupy Mars as well. We're really excited about the MarsVR Indiegogo crowdfunding campaign. We have a little bit of time remaining, so we'd love to get your support with our campaign. There are several rewards available. You can sponsor a school or museum. You can place your name in MarsVR, and you'll also be able to place your name in Occupy Mars at the same time with the same pledge level. We also have several other rewards available that offer unique VR hardware accessories, such as a smell hardware from Celia and a treadmill made by Infinidec. So it's just like the treadmill from the movie Ready Player One. You can use it to walk around on Mars and stay in the same place physically on Earth. So that's all for now. We're really excited about the partnership we have with Occupy Mars, and we'll look to see you in the next episodes of TightBeam for Mars. And I hope to see more details about living inside Martian habitats, such as our FMARS station up in the Canadian Arctic. Thanks, everybody, and we'll see you on Mars.
See you on the next episode of the TightBeam from Mars, where we will show you more details about living inside Martian habitats.